Artificial intelligence is easily one of the most prevalent themes in all of science fiction. The idea that the machine could exhibit the same level of intelligence and sentience as a human being has captivated writers and audiences alike for decades, from an ominous computer system in 2001, A Space Odyssey.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
To superhuman androids in Westworld.
Turn the other cheek.
This captivating subgenre of science fiction has experienced a diverse range of depictions. But fiction has a habit of romanticizing certain aspects, such as the frequent inclusion of humanoid robots. Building a robot in pursuit of AI is a bit like constructing the chassis of a car before the internal combustion engine was even invented. But I guess anthropomorphism is just an easier solution than expecting audiences to get emotionally attached to a few lines of code. Unless you're Joaquin Phoenix, of course, but that dude can do anything. In recent years, a few outspoken intellectuals, such as Elon Musk, Sam Harris, Stephen Hawking, Nick Bostrom, to name a few, have voiced genuine concerns for the rise of artificial intelligence, as brilliant minds across the globe are competing to retrace the hundreds of millions of years of evolution that resulted in the human brain. And while many experts have no doubts about machines' ability to achieve human-level intelligence at some point in the future, just as many believe it to be an impossibility. And perhaps it is. Perhaps we are incomprehensibly complex in such a way that we cannot do what nature has done to us. Then again, if random mutations can lead to intelligence, how hard can it be? In fact, even though evolution had a hell of a head start, machines have already surpassed us in some limited domains. Take the two popular board games chess and go. The best human chess and go players in the world have been defeated by artificial intelligence. Just think about that. No human player will ever again become the best at either of these two games. No matter how hard you try, even if you dedicate your entire life to become the best player you could possibly be, it will never be enough. Luckily for us, there's a lot more to the human condition than chess and Go, but is it that dubious to think that more general talents and abilities could be rendered equally obsolete? Assuming it's possible, what happens when machines become more competent at performing any and all physical and mental labor? If AI becomes more competent in every regard, then what purpose or function would be left for us to serve? The music playing in the background of this video was entirely composed by a machine.
Dzień dobry Państwu, Krzysztof Węglarz. Szanowni Państwo, witam Państwa bardzo serdecznie w drugim dniu Forum Gospodarczego PTIME. Szanowni Państwo, w imieniu Krajowej Izby Gospodarczej Elektroniki i Telekomunikacji oraz Polskiej Izby Informatyki i Telekomunikacji bardzo Państwu dziękuję za obecność. Chciałem przypomnieć, że w pierwszym dniu forum, w dniu wczorajszym, mieliśmy omawialiśmy wiele tematów związanych z sztuczną inteligencją. Film, który żeście przed Państwem przed chwilą widzieli, był takim podsumowaniem zagadnień, które będziemy poruszać na które poruszaliśmy w dniu wczorajszym i w dniu dzisiejszym. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to remind you that during the conference we provided with simultaneous translation from Polish into English and English into Polish as well. If there is anybody who needs a headset, you can receive them in the conference room. Szanowni Państwo, jeśli ktoś z Państwa potrzebuje tłumaczenia symultanicznego, w rogu, w po prawej stronie sali można odebrać zestaw słuchawkami. Proszę Państwa, teraz nie pozostaje mi nic innego, jak zaprosić naszego pierwszego gościa i poprosić o wystąpienie. Temat wystąpienia: Europejska Strategia Cyfryzacji Przemysłu. Please welcome Max Lemke, Head of Unit for Complex System and Advising Computing in Director and General Content of the European Commission. Max, you're very welcome. Proszę o brawa. And the stage is yours.
Morning. Yes, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome here on the second day of the conference. I would like to give you a bit of a flavor of Europe's strategy for digitizing industry. That's the Industry 4.0 chapeau across the national initiatives that we have across Europe, and how we add value to national and regional investments on a European scale. I must say, when you look at the situation of Europe today, this is one of the topics where we got agreement across all member states that there is a need to act on a European level, and if we act on a European level, we can be stronger on the world market. With we, I mean the European ecosystem of our industry. And that is what I would like to start with, to give you just an idea of what we have in mind and what we believe digitization is. We see three major dimensions of value creation from digitization. And you could, today they are often seen very separate. You see digital in all kinds of products. You see the car. In some years, 60, 70, 80% of the cost of a car will be related to digital technologies. So there's digital inside, we don't see it anymore. So, and then we see the processes on how to get there, the manufacturing of all kinds of things, the digital transformation of the processes. We see 3D printing, we see all the connectivity of our production plants around the world. And last not least, we see a change in business models when you see how the online actors have built their business models around platforms, the platform economy, the servitization. You see huge changes that are happening. I'm not saying that we should change everything we do, but everybody, every company in Europe, wherever located, whatever size, whatever sector, should look into what digital transformation means for him and how he sees these three value, these three dimensions interact. So it's not just we can look at one or the other, we have to look at it as a whole. Now, what are the technologies driving this change? I mean, it's pretty clear you have an event here on artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence, I believe, is the next game changer that is coming. At the moment, it's in the labs. We are starting using it, but it will come everywhere in future. That's what we believe. We have seen this already, or we believe this already to happen in the early 90s and 80s of the last century, and it didn't take off. And now it's coming back because we have the compute resources, we have the data, we have the connectivity to really make it happen. So artificial intelligence and autonomous systems are the real digital game changers that are coming, combined with the Internet of Things and combined with all the value creation from big data. And these three big groups of technologies are leading to innovation in products, processes, and business models. Now, when you look at these value chains in different sectors of industry, like the automotive sector, the manufacturing sector, the health sector, what we see is that value chains and value constellations, if you want, it's not linear chains anymore, they are changing. And you see, just to give you two examples from automotive, you see Tesla, they were not manufacturing cars before. They just came and now they manufacture cars. We see a similar spin-off of Fraunhofer in Aachen, who is now mass producing electrical vans for the postal services. They had a spin-off, and the spin-off has been bought by Deutsche Post because they wanted an electrical van, and the car manufacturers didn't go fast enough. So they started it on their own, and now they own the manufacturing of the van. So that basically says value chains are changing, and new actors can get into the game what we never expected before, and in particular, all the knowledge about artificial intelligence, big data, Internet of Things becomes part of it and is becoming part of the value chains where we didn't see them before. Now, when I look at the level of digitization, it differs very much across Europe. When we see something like 54% of large companies is highly digitized in the EU, but only 17% of SMEs. More than 50% of companies in ICT, telecommunications, media in particular are highly digitized, but when you look at the companies in the more traditional sectors, construction, metal manufacturing, food, we see much lower percentages. Also across countries, across regions, 47% of the Danish companies are highly digitized, 12% in Greece, and we have a figure for Poland around 15%. Yeah, so that just gives an idea that we are very fragmented across Europe, and we have to bring that a bit more together. And that's what we try to do through our digitizing European industry strategy that we have. So we know where we are strong, we know where we are not so strong. Like if we look at the manufacturing, at electronics for all kinds of applications in automotive or in energy, robotics, there Europe is strong. So bringing engineering excellence into the digital world, that's a bit what a German study said, that's the European strength. We start from our knowledge in engineering, we start from our ecosystems that we have around in engineering, and we see how that goes into the digital world and how we add value through digital in that engineering world. Okay, so that's whereas some actors from outside Europe go the other way around. They are strong on the digital, but they don't have the ecosystem on the engineering side, so it's a kind of different situation. And I tell you, we in Europe, we have such strong engineering ecosystem in different parts of Europe, you cannot just buy them, because it's not just one company, it's a whole ecosystem in a region that is existing. And you can see examples like automotive around Stuttgart, or the aerospace around Toulouse and so on. But they have to develop further, obviously. We are good in research and technology institutions all across, including in Poland. And we have very traditional sectors and a lot of SMEs. So that's a bit our strengths. We know we are not that good or even bad in some areas like the big data platforms. There Europe is behind on the online internet actions and so on. Now, what I would like to show you now is we have published a year ago a communication digitizing European industry, and I would like to run you through our strategy and give you some flavor of that. You can read more on the internet or go into details of my slides. The key message here is we want to add value on European level. This is not reinventing the wheel and have a 29th initiative on top of the 28 that are already emerging at the moment. Yeah? So we try to add value, we try to concentrate, and these are the five areas that I have highlighted above. The five areas on top are the areas where we see added value if we act together on a European scale. And our way of working is we would like to add value, we would like to see what is happening in the member states, we want to coordinate in a bottom-up way, not having the finger up and say this is how you should all do it. Yeah, we are all different, we have different geometries, and we should live on that. Now let me go through some of these areas. I first will go into the coordination, the governance framework. Then I will go into what we call digital innovation hubs across Europe. I say a little bit about platforms, and I go into the skills and the regulatory issues briefly. Now, governance. Digitizing industry has a light governance structure. The governance means We are working with the national initiatives. I know that Poland is at the moment building up a national initiative on Industry 4.0. We have roundtables, very high-level roundtables with the commissioner, where issues are discussed, where it's discussed what should be done on European scale. And we have one big stakeholder forum per year. We had the first stakeholder forum end of January, early February in Essen with 100 participants, and there was also quite some participation from your country there. That's where we meet, that's where we network across Europe. Now, when we look at the map, we have at the moment 13 initiatives, and we are launching in 2 weeks the platform of platforms, the EUI 4.0, EU Industry 4.0, which is the platform of the national platform. And this concept platform of platform already tells what we mean by that. We want to bring the European national platforms together and add value there. Polish Industry 4.0 platform, the Polish Industry 4.0 platform is under preparation as we understand. And we have, my colleague and me, we have meetings today to find out a bit more what is happening there and see. Now, I come to the first point, digital innovation hubs. One of the key objectives of the initiative, Digitizing Industry, is to ensure that any industry in Europe, big or small, wherever situated, whatever sector, I repeat that, has access to advanced digital technologies and competences. So the goal is to set up a pan-European network of digital innovation hubs. Obviously, that cannot come from all from European money. That has to come from through a combination of different resources. So it's the role of the member states and regions to build up their local infrastructure, to build up their local digital innovation hubs, the hubs that are offering services to SMEs, to mid-caps, Mittelstand, on their digital transformation, to allow every company to look into what digital transformation brings to them. What we do on a European scale is we add value in a sense that one local center cannot know everything, cannot know all technologies, cannot have all expertise. So we want to make sure that we get a one-stop shop. The local SME goes to the local center, and the center would know where to find all the information across Europe around. And we would also finance this kind of collaboration on a cross-border, in a cross-border scheme. So high-level innovation across borders. Further, we are at the moment developing a dynamic map of competences all across Europe so that people who need expertise know where to find them. And that will be linked to the smart specialization platform that our DG Regio, Director General Regio, Regional and Structural Funds colleagues are doing, looking into what the region is strong at and what kind of plans are existing for the region. Further on, we are having a scheme which we call mentoring and sponsorship scheme, which is for less developed regions to get a bit of money to do a feasibility study on building innovation hubs in their region. And we have had some examples. We put for 20 centers or so, we put 50,000 euros on the table and said, use these 50,000 euros to get guidance from existing centers elsewhere and develop your plan. Look into what is the strength of your region, look into what kind of digital game changers are the most relevant for you, look where the expertise is, and look how you can build up the kind of digital innovation hub service for the companies in your region. When we are redoing this now, and we'll have a call around, I would say, April, May, for another 30 or so feasibility studies just for Eastern Europe, just for the what we call the EU13, the member states that joined together with a whole group of Eastern European ones, because there we see still a lot of white spots and we would like to encourage and support that. Now, on a European scale, how do we add value? How do we support cross-border collaboration? We have initiatives like ICT for Manufacturing SMEs, where we support many experiments. That's usually a user, a supplier, and 1, 2, 3 competence centers who look at a digital transformation experiment, a digital transformation case of a user, and look at how this digital transformation can be done and even play it through. So this is a big initiative across Europe. It's mostly cross-border collaboration. It's around 70 competence centers, 280 experiments. Most of the partners in this are SMEs, and we simp from 29 member states and associated countries. And what is important here is really newcomers in the program, and we simplify in a sense that we do not have contracts from Europe, from Brussels, with all the SMEs, but it's the local center who has this contract with the SMEs in order to simplify and get rid of the red tape and the fear to work directly with the Commission. So that's an example of what we have. When I look at Poland, just to give you a bit of flavor on how Polish involvement is, we see Polish involvement in this I4MS initiative through two companies who have been one of the partners in there, and through Funding Box being involved in the mentoring and sponsorship program. We are aware of hubs in digital innovation hubs like HPC for Poland around the Poznan Supercomputing Center, IoT Turun, and the Cybersecurity Hub. So this is what we know. I know there is more, but I wanted to show we have looked into it a little bit, but there's more. And one of the reasons for being here today is also to look deeper into the Polish infrastructure. Now, another area that we are working on is the building of platforms. You read in the press a lot about the platform economy, the online actors gradually building a tool, growing it, and suddenly having a platform like the operating system in a smartphone, like for example Android or the Apple operating system, which is the platform for the hardware, the sensors, the connection, the physical world coming together with the applications. Yeah, it's the platform on which things happen. And you see that as well when you look at all the online tools that are available. They are usually centered around an open or a proprietary platform. When you extend that concept to industry, you could say, look at the factory. In the factory, you have all your machines, and you have all your applications that you want to do within the factory or in collaboration across the value chain. And there are tools in the middle. You may know about the RAMI, the Reference Architecture Industry 4.0 in Germany. You may know about industrial data space, which is a data space, how to use industrial data, how to make sure that it's only used by those who are allowed to use it. We have the S3P French platform, which looks at time and safety critical IoT applications or platform for those. And there is a lot of these platforms that in a marketplace bring together different groups of actors around a platform to create a fair market value. So we are promoting in the program leadership in digital industrial value chains to align our efforts and in particular focus around platform building. That means we look at key technologies and their integration. We look at how we bring that to platforms. Imagine an SME that wants to digitize. It cannot just do it alone. It needs a lot of ingredients. And these ingredients are normally available through platforms and the different actors in that platform. Reference architectures, interoperability frameworks. And what is our vision for that is those have to be driven by EU interests as well. Yeah, so this is why we put quite some effort in our innovation programs to support that. So what we are suggesting here is to work together across industry, across member states, on platforms, interoperability frameworks, integration frameworks, reference architectures, and develop them bottom up. You do a draft, you do testing in labs, test beds, you go larger in testing, you go to system level, and you experiment, and with that, you gradually grow a platform, you go into standardization bodies, and at the same time build ecosystems by getting new players involved. This is how the online platforms are growing. And use, if possible, all the kinds of mechanisms we have available in Europe in terms of funding and pooling of investment. So we would put the European money on the table, that's what I call federation, in order to be the linking pin between what is already happening in the member states. But bottom up, from you, it can only work if you come, it's not from us. So the overall goal, just to remind you on that line, is EU actors to join forces along common interest in the platform economy. And that means future global standards and platforms driven by interests of EU actors. Now let me get briefly into the final two topics that I would just like to scratch a bit. Obviously, yes, we are working, the Commission is a regulatory body as well. We are looking at regulation or deregulation or what is necessary in terms of regulation on the data economy. You all know that the digital revolution is built on data. I don't think I have to go into more of that. And what you discussed yesterday on artificial intelligence is very closely linked. We have the connectivity through the IoT, we have the data, and we use artificial intelligence to interpret the data and to derive certain action from that. And we learn. Deep learning is one of the buzzwords there. Question always is, who owns the data? Because if we want to use industrial data, it has to be clear who owns it, and it has to be also made sure that only the ones who own it can use it, or the ones who have the rights to use it. So that there are the network providers, there are the machine providers, there are the factory owners, and we have learned, we had a communication to Council and Parliament in January, and where we put the issues on the table, because we did not yet know how to put together what member states want. So now we have a consultation process to which all the stakeholders are invited until April to give their view, and then the Commission will see what kind of regulation, or if there is any regulation needed, or whether contract law would be sufficient. And we would go into more detail into looking into that. So there's a consultation ongoing at the moment on what constituency thinks should be done. And issues that are addressed in this is the free flow of data. That means removing data localization restrictions, except if they are required for national security and similar objectives. You see that in some countries, for example. Data access and transfer, making machine-generated data more accessible for businesses to boost innovation and the digital economy. So it has to be clear, you need the data in order to do your new applications. It's around data portability, interoperability, and standards. It's also about liability in terms of autonomous systems, for example. Imagine an autonomous system, a robot, a car, does something wrong. There is something on who is liable on that. Yeah, and this is a key issue on the autonomous car. We see that being addressed. In other areas, we see it less addressed, but it's a key issue. And also experimentation and testing. For example, to test autonomous cars, we need cross-border testing. You don't want to change regulation every time you cross the border. Like in one country, you have to put the hands on the steering wheel, you cross the border, and then you can take them off. You want to have the same kind of regulation across Europe. And we need testing corridors for that. Another issue is cybersecurity that is addressed strongly. The cyberspace, we know, is the backbone of the digital society. But cybersecurity incidents undermine trust in digital services. So we are looking into that. We had a communication in 2016 on strengthening Europe's cyber resilience systems. And we are, as a conclusion from there, looking at the moment into ICT security certification frameworks that increase trust and security of products and ICT-based products and services, that look at the integration of ICT security certification in sector-specific legislative proposals. You know, security, you have to do at all levels. If you forget it at one level, the attack will come exactly from where the security is weak. And we also assess the feasibility and impact of a European cybersecurity labeling framework to increase the trust. Now, last topic before I come to conclusion. Obviously, I mean, we are all aware that skills is a big issue. Digitization is transforming the economy, but we need digital skills everywhere. We do not just have a lack of digital engineers, informatica, across Europe and across the world, but we on top have a lack of the blue and white collar working, picking up digital competences in order to move the way his job is moving into using digital. And we have to strongly work on that. That's why we build upon and expand the Grand Coalition for Digital. Coalition for Digital Skills and Jobs, and we implement parts of this new skills agenda, in particular looking at the issue of skills for everybody, not just for the digital engineer, but digital skills from school onwards, into universities, into the job, so that blue and white collar workers who in the past were working with their hands and machines could now, for example, program a robot or do a data analytics simulation. And I would like to conclude all of this. The digital transformation, from our point of view, from the Commission, the European side, concerns everyone. It requires a proactive approach of all sectors. That basically means SMEs should look into their digital transformation. If they don't do it, they may be dead before they recognize. So it's time really to look into it. It doesn't mean they have to change, but they should look at whether they have to change. And that, I think, is absolutely important. We should build on our strength in Europe. We have strength, but we have to get out of our cocoon and go and look at the digital transformation. And for that, we need the networks of hubs, for example, so that everybody has a chance to do that. The Digitizing European Industry Initiative builds on top of national initiatives. It's not trying to reinvent the wheel. It tries to add value, and it focuses on these measures. We don't want to do everything. Then we would have a 100, 200 item shopping list. No, we try to concentrate on where we add value, on digital innovation hubs, for example. We say the national, regional infrastructures have to build from regional funding or structural funds, whatever is available in whatever region, and we only add on the networking and collaboration level. Digitization offers a huge opportunity for Polish industry. We see 12% growth of added value in manufacturing from 2007 to 2014, so it's a manufacturing country. We see promising plans from the Polish for a Polish Industry 4.0 platform. We strongly encourage that one is built to be part of the platform of platforms. And we see a strong network of competence centers with industry growing. Now, just one last word of warning. We talk a lot about technologies here, and we are now building up working groups as well on one other issue that is extremely important. The digital transformation of our economy and society is also about jobs and social aspects and the future. So, and we see citizens who fear, and citizens who fear and think digitization means is a job killer. To some extent, some jobs will disappear, some new ones will come. There are different studies. Some will say we will lose in the long term. Others will say it will stay balanced. But I think what is clear here, and I don't want to predict that, but what is clear here is people need to change. Their job will change. The job in 20 years will not be as the job is today. So it's important to do an inclusive approach towards digital transformation and not just look at the technologies and at artificial intelligence getting rid of another 10,000 workers. We have to see how we bring that together and how we create the new jobs that create the new tools, that manage the new tools. So we need to take due consideration for the fears of the European citizen. Otherwise, the digital transformation will not happen because the citizen at the end will refuse it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Max.